Today we're going to be talking about infant holy, infant lowly, the birth and work of Christ on the cross, found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 to 11. Hear God's word. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray. Father, we praise you for the gift of your Son, and Lord Jesus, for your wonderful grace. And we ask, O Holy Spirit, just for your outpouring, your work in our hearts, that you would use the Word of God to encourage us, change us, transform us, so that you would be given all the praise. In Jesus' good name, amen. Can you imagine the most powerful and richest person in the world having a child, and there was no room for them in any hospital, in any sanitary place, and this rich and powerful person had to have their child in a barn? According to the internet right now, the richest person and most powerful person in the world is Elon Musk. So let us imagine for a second that Elon Musk had to have his child in a barn because there's no room in any hospital for this child to be born. That would be a shock to Elon. That would be a shock to the world. When we think about Jesus and his birth, sometimes we might not fully grasp the depths of his humility, how great his humility was for humanity. Jesus was with God the Father in the beginning in heaven. Jesus had fellowship at the right hand of God the Father. There was no concern for Jesus of people wanting to kill him or hurt him or not liking him. But then Jesus assumed human nature, was conceived in the womb of Mary, and was born. But God's Son was not born in a luxurious accommodation where rich people stayed. Jesus, who is the King of the universe, was born in the lowest of all places, a manger. The birth of Jesus was certainly a lowly and humble birth. There was a saying that was popular in the 80s that some of you might remember. If you left the door open in winter, someone would shout out to you, "Shut the door, were you born in a barn?" Or if you were making a mess in the house, someone would criticize you saying, "Clean up, were you born in a barn?" These comments were made to motivate you or even to shame you into doing something, because people who are born in a barn are lowly people. To be born in a manger or a barn would have been a lowly birth indeed, but this is where Jesus, the King of Heaven, was born. And hear this story in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration where Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went out to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, it came time for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Where Jesus was born was no accident. The place of his birth, thus that fulfills the word of God. But it was as well to show that he would be a humble king, a humble Savior. Today we're looking at the book of Philippians and the Christmas message. The book of Philippians was written by Paul the Apostle to the church that was at the city of Philippi, which is now found in modern day Greece. Philippi was an important city to the Romans, who was the predominant government over that area, because it had a lot of military personnel there. Paul wrote this book of Philippians for several reasons: to thank the church for their generous support for the ministry of Paul's preaching. Next, to inform the church about the current situation. He's in prison because of preaching. To warn the church about people who are distorting the gospel. And we read about those people that Paul calls dogs, those who mutilate the flesh. And finally, to encourage the church in unity. There's people who are not unified, and he encourages them to walk humbly. And we read about that in chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. Paul encourages these Christians with these 8 commands that will fill up his joy. In Philippians 2, verses 2 to 4, he exhorts these Christians to be of the same mind, have the same love, be in one accord, be of one mind, do nothing out of selfish ambition, do nothing from conceit. In humility, consider others better than yourselves, and don't look out for your own interests, but also the interests of others. These Christians are to have the same mind or the same attitude that was in Jesus Christ. And then Paul records this early Christian song, this early Christian hymn in Philippians 2, 6 to 11 about the humility of Jesus. And Jesus is the greatest example of humility. And this Christian song can really be broken down into 3 sections. In verses 6 to 8, we hear about the humility of Jesus. In verses 9 of chapter 2 of Philippians, we see that God exalted Jesus. And in 2, verse 10 to 11, praise and adoration is given to Jesus. Let's look at the humility of Jesus in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 to 8. In 2, verses 6, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. Jesus is described as being in the form of God. And it might seem like a strange way to describe someone, but what Paul is getting at here is that Jesus has the form of God, thus he is equal with God, and thus he is God. Paul reminds us of an important truth about Jesus Christ that sometimes people forget about Jesus. Jesus has always existed. Jesus was not created. Jesus was with the Father in the beginning, reigning and ruling with God the Father. This is because Jesus is God. Now, John wrote about the pre-existent Christ in his gospel. John 1, verses 1 to 2. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. So there we have Jesus. He's God, and he's with God in the beginning. But also Jesus said this about himself in John 17, verse 5. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. And there Jesus talks to his God the Father, prays to the Father, and talks about the glory that he had even before the creation of the world with his Father. Just to be ultra clear, Jesus did not come into existence when he was born of the Virgin Mary. Jesus existed with the Father from eternity and created all things with the Father. Even though Jesus is God, he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. This means that Jesus gave up being with God the Father in heaven to do something amazing for the world. In 2 verse 7 it says, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Jesus is God and was with God in the beginning, but Jesus emptied himself. This does not mean that Jesus gave up being God, But Jesus came to the earth to serve. Now, this is an amazing truth. Jesus is worthy of all praise that we could ever give him. But Jesus didn't come to the earth looking for that. He came and was born in a humble place, and he came to serve. Jesus serves sinful humans by assuming human nature or becoming flesh. Now, just by way of an illustration here, I recognize that probably listening to this sermon, there's probably not too many Alice Cooper fans listening, but he's apparently returned to the Lord. He's now seeking to serve the Lord. And someone captured him serving food to less fortunate children. Now, here we have Alice Cooper, a very famous rock star. He could pay for hundreds of people to do that, but he wanted to serve the less fortunate children himself. Here we have Alice Cooper, a famous rock star, serving people who don't even know who he is. That's an act of humility and service. But how much greater is the service of Jesus Christ, who created the universe and sustains all things by his power. And Jesus serves sinful people in an amazing way. He dies on the cross. And that's what we read about in Philippians 2, verse 8. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus assumed human nature. He humbled himself. Jesus was humble in every aspect of his life. And while Jesus was on earth, he served. He didn't come to be served, but he came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And we see many great acts of service in the life of Christ. And one of them is told in John 13, where Jesus washes the disciples' feet. John 13, verse 3 to 5, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Now, washing feet was not just something that everybody did. Washing feet was the job of only a servant. But here we have the Lord, the King of the universe, creator of all things, stooping down to do something that only the lowliest of the low do, washing his disciples' feet. But Jesus showed his greatest act of humility and service by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. First, Jesus was obedient to the Father and lived a perfect life here on earth. He never sinned, so that he could be that perfect and sinless sacrifice for people like us who are sinners. Jesus was righteous in every way so that he could die in our place on the cross. And Jesus went to the cross to show the ultimate act of humility and service. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For our sake, he, that's God, made him, that's Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin." So Jesus took upon sin, even though he never sinned, so that in him, that's Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus didn't know sin. He took upon sin so that sinners who trust in Jesus Christ could become righteous. And those who trust in Christ can be made right with God and declared righteous in God's eyes as if they have never sinned. Your guilt can be gone. Well, let's look at 2 verse 9. God exalted Jesus. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name. Jesus showed great humility, but God highly exalted Jesus. Jesus is given a name that is above every name, and the name is the Lord Jesus Christ. The name of Jesus refers to him being a savior or deliverer. That's what his name means. This name was given to him at his birth, as commanded by God to his parents. His parents name him Jesus. because he will save his people from their sins. The name of Jesus refers to the humanity of Jesus Christ. He was the Christ. He's the Messiah who would suffer and die in place of sinners so that they could be forgiven. And Jesus is also given Lord. The name Lord refers to his kingship. Jesus is the sovereign master, ruler, king over the universe. Jesus Christ is the Savior, King, and glorious God, glorious Lord. Christian, make it your life goal to honor the name of the Lord Jesus with your lips and with your life. And point number three, praise to Jesus in 2 verse 10. So that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. In Philippians 2:10, Paul shows us how Christ will be exalted. When you bow down before someone, you're showing reverence to them. For instance, in the all-anticipated boxing match between Jake Paul and Mike Tyson, Jake Paul bowed down before Mike Tyson to show that he respected and revered him because he was the best boxer who ever lived. But here, Paul talks about the ultimate bowing down before the great God and King Jesus Christ. And three groups of people will bow down in reverence before God: those in heaven, those on the earth, and those under the earth. First, those in heaven. Paul's speaking about the angelic beings in heaven. Although angels are a great and powerful part of God's creation, they themselves will bow down in humility to the great King Jesus. Those on the earth. Paul speaks of humans who are living on the earth. All humans will bow down either in joy or in agony to the great God and Savior Jesus Christ. Those who know Jesus and love him will bow down in joy because of his wonderful grace, because they anticipate his coming and life with him. And those who do not know Jesus will bow down in agony because he's a holy God who hates sin and punishes sin. And then finally, those under the earth. Paul is speaking of those who have died. All who have lived and have passed away will bow down with either joy or agony. But there's one more thing. In 2 verse 11, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Not only will everyone bow in reverence, but all will confess that Jesus is Lord. The phrase "Jesus is Lord" was the first Christian creed. The confession of this creed, "Jesus is Lord," showed that you were a Christian when you declared it. And Paul talks about believing in your heart and confessing with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Romans 10, verse 10 to 11. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. When you declare Jesus is Lord and mean it with all your being, you are saying Jesus made you. He is the creator. I am the creation. I'm a sinner. He's a holy God. And I need Jesus Christ and his work on the cross to forgive me of my sins, to reconcile me to God. Well, how does this hymn apply to our hearts and lives? And there's really two things to ponder and to apply. First, the humility of Jesus is the greatest gift for you. The Christmas song, though, Infant Lowly, helps us understand the attitude of many concerning Jesus Christ. Many do not understand the greatness of Jesus. In that hymn, it says, "Infant holy, infant lowly, for his bed a cattle stall. Oxen lowing, little knowing, Christ, the babe, is Lord of all." And Jesus showed this great humility by becoming human, living life on this earth perfectly, dealing with many difficult people, some who wanted to kill him, and some did kill him. But Jesus shows the greatest act of humility by dying on the cross for sinful humans. Now, just a question. Do you think the rich and powerful billionaires of our day would die in your place, would take your sin and take the punishment for it. Do you think that someone who owns billions of dollars in real estate and equities is just going to give it all up and die for you? Not a chance. But Jesus, who is King of the universe, suffered and died on the cross so that sinners could experience God's grace. We read in Philippians 2, verse 8, that Jesus was obedient in his life till death on the cross. Jesus went to the cross to bear the ultimate price in place of sinners. And Isaiah 53 speaks about this humility of Christ. It's written hundreds of years before Jesus would come. This is a prophecy about Jesus. And it speaks about his humility. He was despised, rejected by men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one who would hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we're healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we've turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The King who created the universe, Jesus Christ, had laid on him the punishment of the sins of the world. Christian, you have amazing privilege. Your sins are forgiven. Christian, you sinned, but through Christ, that sin no longer defines you anymore. Jesus Christ has taken away your sin. You have peace with God. That barrier between you and God because of your sin has been taken away, and you have fellowship with communion with God, and you have joy. The Christian song called Good Christian Men Rejoice helps us understand the salvation and the joy that we should experience, not just at Christmas, but year-round. Now ye need not fear the grave. Don't have to fear death anymore. Peace, peace, because you have peace through Christ, peace with God. Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you one and calls you all to gain his everlasting hall. Christ was born to save. Christian, I hope you're joyful with the peace that Jesus gives you. Remind yourself of the work of Christ and ponder God's amazing grace often. And today, if you do not know Jesus and his amazing grace, today's the day to get right with him. Stay no longer in your sin and rebellion against God. Forsake your sin. Trust Christ. Trust Christ so you can gain his everlasting hall, his everlasting life. And it's only because the work he's accomplished for you. And then you can know the true meaning of Christmas, which is joy in Jesus and peace with God. And finally, Christians, live humbly before the one who humbled himself for you. There was a highly educated professor known for his arrogance. And I remember studying at the University of Toronto, there were lots of professors who, you know, who had those amazing suits. They were always wearing brown. They had trim beards. They looked smart. They talked in a fake British accent just to impress you and so that you knew that they were smart. Well, there was this highly educated professor known for his arrogance. He decided to take a leisurely boat ride across a wide river in a small rickety boat with a lowly rower. The professor was eager to show off, and he asked the boatman, "Have you ever studied philosophy?" The boatman said, "No." "Ah, what a waste," exclaimed the professor. "If you haven't studied philosophy, you've wasted your life." A few moments later, the professor asked, "Boatman, have you ever studied astronomy?" "No, sir," the boatman replied. "Terrible, what a waste of your life. How do you not understand the stars and the universe?" "Have you at least studied literature?" the professor asked. The boatman, embarrassed, answered, "No, sir, I've never learned to read." The professor again claimed he wasted his life. But just then something crazy happened. The boat sprung a leak. Water was coming in like crazy. The boatman said calmly, "Do you know how to swim?" The professor looked up in a panic. "No, I never learned to swim." "Well, sir, it seems your entire life is about to be wasted." This story can sum up the message of Jesus that he taught over and over again. It's talked about in Luke 14, verse 11. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Not only did Jesus teach if you humble yourself, you'll be exalted, and if you exalt yourself, you'll be humbled. Jesus lived this teaching. In Philippians 2, verses 6 to 11, we see how Jesus lived humbly. Jesus gave up the benefits of being with God the Father in heaven, then became a human and lived and served people. Jesus' greatest act of service was his death on the cross for people. And just a quick prayer. Lord Jesus, make us humble people. In Philippians 2, verse 5, we're exhorted to have the same attitude that was in Christ Jesus. But humility is something that's really not in our nature. We're prone to exalt ourselves. We're very prone to think more highly of ourselves than we ought to, and we are prone to be prideful people. When others succeed, we hate it because they become successful because we're envious and prideful. This is not what the Lord commands us to be. First, we must be reminded of Christ's humility on the cross and be changed and transformed by God's grace. Next, we must repent and be sorry for our spirit of pride and arrogance. And then we must walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, seeking to live a humble life, a life that honors the Lord. Hear how James exhorts us to be humble people. James 4, 6 to 7. But he gives us more grace, therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. At Christmas, we're reminded of the humility of Christ. He left the Father to humble himself and die for sinners like you and me. Christian, rejoice in the humility of Christ. Christian, seek to live a humble life.